for coming, everyone.
Will über IMSI Catcher reden.
I would like to speak about IMSI Catchers and playing tag or hide and seek with IMSI Catchers and explain why they're pretty bad at playing hide and seek. This is going to be the outline of my talk. I'll be speaking about what an IMSI Catcher is, what they can do,
wie man sie dabei
and how you can observe them in doing that, and then give you some practical examples.
Und zum Schluss würde ich noch
and to conclude, I would like to look into the future and explain why this is not likely to get better with 4G and 5G. I've been working on this subject for 4 years now at the GCKI in Berlin, and that's where I have my experience from. What are IMSI catchers? There are various varieties of these. On the left, you see a device that fits in a backpack or even a small handbag. Then there are these antiquated, homemade devices that use SDRs or highly complex suitcases. And so the range of what IMSI catchers can do is pretty broad as well.
Telefone einfangen und irgendwie
from catching phones and reading base data to opening call histories. IMSI catchers
nachmachen oder so
imitate normal base stations or pretend to open a new one.
Aber weil sie praktisch darauf aus sind.
But in order to do this, because they're after catching phones, they have to make themselves very attractive to telephones. And that's why they tend to be fairly obvious. And IMSI catchers can start as individual base stations where they only open one base station, but they're also very complex setups where a base station opens 2G, 3G and 4G simultaneously, and that's why the range of what they can do is very large. And this leads to the fact that also explains its name, that they try to read the IMSI and IMEI of telephones. That's a classic setup, and the name really gives it away.
Mir immer dazu einfällt und ich so auch erzähle.
The anecdote I tend to tell here is that it started as a surveillance instrument for police.
Bei Leuten, die sie überwachen wollen, die aber irgendwie oft ihre Telefone
und order to find people who whom they wanted to surveil, but who tended to change telephones a lot, and that's where they started using IMSI catchers to find out what the current phone contract of the person we're interested in is. So they would open these IMSI catchers or place these IMSI catchers.
Buchen sich da alle Telefone ein, die in der Nähe sind.
All the telephones that are in the vicinity register with this base stations, and they do this a few times at various places, and finally they'll know which IMSI corresponds to the target person. That's where their name comes from. That's the classic model. But of course, these days they can do a lot more than simply reading IMSIs, and this ranges from location determining location down to a few meters to reading data traffic and completely jamming communication. I'm going to explain in detail how this works, and I will start with reading IMSIs and IMIEs of a baseband.
Die E-Mails werden beim Authentifizieren irgendwie.
During authentication, these are sent for the first time.
Das ist sozusagen beim ersten Nutzen eines Netzes oder einer Basis.
So when you use a network or a base station for the first time, that's what happens. And after that, there's a mechanism in the phone specs
wenn man sich bewegt,
that is called location update. It's meant for moving from one cell to or location area to the next. And when you do this, the IMSI is sent another time, and that's a mechanism that IMSI catchers like to use. Location updates are also done to regularly tell the network, well, ping the network or say, tell the network, hi, I'm still here, and there too the IMSI is sent along, and that's the base mechanism that IMSI catchers use to read IMSIs. For determining location, they use features of 4G that are called measurement reports. They're built into the network to give telephones and basebands give them the best possible network, and they can. The network can ask the telephone where it is, and the telephone replies with its location, and that's of course a mechanism that IMSI catchers like to exploit. This feature doesn't exist in 2G or 3G.
Stärke und Triangulierung mit 2-3 Antennen gemacht.
They use signal strength and triangulation over 3 or 4 antennae to determine location during calls. Bear in mind that these can be silent calls that your telephone doesn't tell you about. So the IMSI catchers start a phone call to your telephone, but your telephone doesn't actually ring. It still sends your location though. There are some very nice patents on this as well. Google is very helpful in searching for patents. You can search all of the registered patents, and IMSI catchers too can't help registering patents. So this is a very good method of understanding how things work. This is an excerpt from one of these patents, and the gist of it is that they have a baseband that's normally used for call handling. They have a state machine that goes from idle, where nothing happens, through ringing or alerting, all the way to an active call. And both parts push the state to one another, and this entire patent is based on the fact that they start opening a call, but then they don't send what the baseband expects. Your telephone never rings, but the resources are still being allocated, and so they can measure where you are. So it's a great idea to look at patents regularly. You can find a lot there.
Der nächste Punkt ist fragt die
ich denn man denkt immer irgendwie well, people often think people often wonder if people can listen in, and they actually can, but it's a very complex setup, so these home built IMSI catchers probably can't do this. As an IMSI catcher, you need at least 2 basebands, one for simulating a normal base station, and another that goes into a sort of client mode in order to continue processing the call. And they have to calculate the encryption keys in order to be able to record or listen in on the call. And previous congresses, talks at previous congresses have shown how these algorithms can be broken. There's the A52 algorithm in 2G, which is a secret service algorithm that was first defined or specified in the 80s. It's been broken for a long time. And if none of this works, there's still SS7, which is a protocol that network devices like to speak among themselves, and this allows to fetch the keys and use them internally. It's a bit more difficult in 3G and 4G, and that's why they try to enforce a downgrade to 2G when you want to make a call, in order to make it easier to listen in on your calls. And this rainbow table lookup is difficult with the mobile resources that an IMSI catcher has.
Und deswegen ist da auch wirklich werden da
and that's why they do IP uplinks and use backends in order to query the Rainbow tables rather quickly, which allows them to decrypt the call live.
Müssen die IMSI catcher dann eben
and all of this is what the IMSI catchers have to coordinate
miteinander in Verbindung bringen
and combine 2G and 3G things where they can downgrade the telephone from 3G to 2G where they can listen in on the call.
Da habe ich wieder so einen Patentexkurs gefunden.
I found another patent on this.
Hier ist genau der
and it shows this process of downgrading from 3G to 2G. That's been patented here. And
aus den UMTS Spezifikationen.
They use mechanisms from the UMTS specifications in order to
Telefon einzureden, dass es jetzt besser auf 2G weiterfunkt mit
tell the telephone to keep to continue on 2G instead of 3G and then they can take over the call.
Das nächste
the next is DOSing the basebands using the capabilities of the IMSI catchers. Of course, a very simple mode
erkennen, dass man nicht mehr telefonieren kann.
And you can recognize these simple IMSI catchers is the fact that you can no longer make calls. You don't get an uplink, you can't really make any calls, SMSs no longer reach their recipient. And that's a great way to notice simple IMSI catchers, but of course initially you're cut off and you don't really notice what's happening. It's more difficult with 4G again. I have a paper from the Technical University of Berlin where
was ähnliches, also da, wie das Location Update bei 4G.
They're using a similar thing to the location update. It's in this case it's a tracking area update
mobile gegenüber dem Netz,
where the mobile tells the network that it wants to enter the next tracking area and then the network tells, or in this case the IMSI catcher tells the handset that it's not allowed.
Reject code
along with a special reject code which causes the mobile device to think that it's no longer allowed to use the 4G network and it never does again until you take out and reinsert the SIM card.
It's somewhat more secure in 4G, but it still is possible and I'm going to come back to that later. This is all happening where normal phones are not showing anything. The baseband is a black box.
Und es gibt auch selbst bei Smartphones keine APIs, um da tiefer.
Even in smartphones there are no APIs which let you see what's going on.
Der Versteckung, mehr kriegt man nicht raus. Und
you get an MCC from your phone operator and that's all.
Aber es gibt natürlich trotzdem irgendwie Schnitte,
there are some ways,
die auch aus Funk und Kongress bekannt sind. Eben,
which are known from Congress and Funk.
Ja, sehr breit verbreitet ist im Markt. Ich weiß nicht die genauen Zahlen, aber so 70% der Telefone haben halt Qualcomm Baseband.
70% of the phone operators are using Qualcomm.
Dann setzen sich verschiedene Projekte schon mit auseinander.
And there's several projects where
oder irgendwie der Dyack Parser
finding ways in this context.
Es gibt halt irgendwie dafür.
The core problem is
eine Debug-Schnittstelle, die Qualcomm.
It's a debug interface that Qualcomm have built for themselves. And there are kernel
als Serial Import bereit, sobald man dann ein Baseband per USB beispielsweise
patches, which can be used for debugging, and Linux is are able to
nachgucken und
use this kernel patches.
Und damit lassen sich dann per Dyack wirklich sehr genau
in this way it's possible to handle the get hands on your L3 raw data which are being forwarded.
Und auch der Baseband State selber lässt sich beobachten, wie
the baseband is possible to identify the baseband
kann man
data
mit irgendwie open source decks, zum Beispiel aus dem Osmocom stack.
And things like the Osmocom stack can be used to
generierten Partner get this. Aufbereiten, sodass das dann alles irgendwie wunderbar sichtbar in Wireshark wird und dann kann man das sehr genau.
So that you can use Wireshark to see what's going on.
Nutzen das irgendwie.
And we have used this to make some kind of baseband firewall, so you can see on your own handy if you're on a
Sensoren in der Gegend.
On an IMSI catcher, and we can place sensor
Zellen, die sich so
devices,
und die sichtbar sind und dann Veränderungen.
So to detect changes if they've in the environment, if someone is starting an IMSI catcher. If you, when you collect the data,
verraten auch hier, das ist hier aus einer Live-Session irgendwie ein bisschen mitgeschnitten. Ich hoffe,
das ist data from a live session.
Erfundene Zellen sind, die haben die Maus ein bisschen dabei.
One can identify some base stations which are invented. Some base stations have no no identity and no location at all. And some of them have location codes which are not correct compared.
Das Baseband und das Handy wieder dazu bringt, ein Location Update zu machen und seine IMSI zu senden, was ja auch.
This is a trick which is being made to make the handset to ask for a new location, for a new connection and
die eben durch das
intercept in this way.
Zum Beispiel mal so ein Location Update.
This is a location update,
wo praktisch das Mobile Phone sagt,
where the handset
machen,
is requesting a location update.
Zeit um ist oder ich wirklich in eine andere Location Area gegangen bin.
At time out or by changing the location, the network is asking for identification. The smartphone is sending an authentication.
Ja, und dann sagt das Netz im Anschluss daran.
And the answer is ciphering commands. And this signal you can use to identify IMSI catchers. At last, there's a TIMSI assigned to the handset. And this could be a temporary ID which will identify the IMSI catchers as well. The algorithms one of the possibilities is to use a fake cipher to stop the use of the A5 algorithm at all. The T3 212 is available in 2.3 and 4G. There's a live system broadcast when the timeout has occurred. That the handset will be requested to make another update and send a request for location. This is a live session recording, O2net from Germany, where you would expect the location to be the.
Und plötzlich
you can locate
schick mir bitte in 6 Minuten noch mal deine IMSI, passt halt nicht.
The time between requests were 39 minutes and it changed to 2, and this is a giveaway for the existence of IMSI catcher. If you see all these parameters, you can conclude, you can see pictures like this. There's someone who allude to make a telecom cell, and he's make some error.
Welche base stations gibt es so in der Umgebung?
He locates base stations in the vicinity and make a slight change to the name. There's a new location code for the existing base station. One can find a new base station. Signal strength is quite high.
Ja, die wurde das allererste Mal plötzlich gesehen bei dem System.
The first observation is being tampered with. There's an unusual value.
Es gibt dann ein sehr auffälliges Bild.
All in all, this is a quite obvious.
Wenn man die Möglichkeit hat, eben auf diese Daten zuzugreifen.
Quite obvious to it's a giveaway that tells you there's an MEC catcher. This is quite easy. It's an old protocol from the 80s.
Dass die Netze sich nicht gegenüber den Telefonen und den Bildern authentifizieren müssen.
Where it was not normal for handsets to be asked for an identification in 3G, 4G.
Leider,
unfortunately. Important communications are taking place in before the identification.
Irgendwie gezeigt. So wird dann versucht.
The encrypted identification. There are simple methods as well. Jamming the 3G, 4G frequencies so the handset will switch back to 2G automatically. It is possible to make a remote update downgrade of the handset using the SS7 protocol to make it use a 2G network only.
Genau, damit irgendwie ist es tatsächlich ein bisschen schwieriger auch in
this makes it harder to do things in 3G, 4G. There are these known attacks, but it's still not secure. And there are several attacks that are based on these principles who are presented in talks and papers. And
irgendwie gesetzt wird.
There are important steps taken before the security mode is activated. In 4G, 5G, it is expected that most of these will still be possible.
Da gibt's dann, glaube ich, auch gleich noch den nächsten Talk zu. Und,
there'll be a later talk on this subject.
Mit dem wir uns beschäftigen.
And we expect MC catchers to be a problem in the future as well.
So als Forderung, die dabei irgendwie am Ende übrig bleiben, ist, dass wir auch
the request we have to state are the we don't
und keiner kann gucken, was da passiert. Also mal neben
the black the principles of having black boxes delivered by
Basebands selber, die sind bekannt und im Umlauf und wir brauchen einfach offene Basebands oder wenigstens Schnittstellen, um die Basebands.
The thing we need are open basebands. The problem is that it's, the software is proprietary Qualcomm. And you have to write 1,000 MDA to sign 1,000 MDAs at Qualcomm to get your hands on anything.
Offene Schnittstellen, um Basebands beobachten zu können.
And
klar, MC-Catcher verbieten, finde ich auch immer eine wichtige Forderung. Und den Security-Modus.
To forbid MC-Catchers is
und natürlich Überwachungsschnittstellen.
A proper demand.
Ja, das war mein kurzer Überblick über das Fangespiel mit MC-Catchern.
That was my overview of playing tag or hide and seek with IMSI catchers, and now we have time for questions and answers. You know how the game works. We have a microphone angel. Just wave to them, or if you're watching the stream, then go to the chat and ask your question there. There is a question from the internet already. The internet wonders what software was being used in the screenshots that you showed. These are screenshots from our system that we use to read out our sensors. It's proprietary software we use. You can ask me in person.
Ja, nicht direkt ansprechen. Welche Kontaktmöglichkeiten?
How do we contact you then? gsmk.de. There are email addresses and contact forms.
Engel. Oder du? Hast du eine Frage?
Do you have a question over there?
Da hat jemand die Hand oben.
Somebody has raised their hand.
Was ist so an IMSI?
Is there an overview of the IMSI catchers that exist on the market? I know in North Rhine-Westphalia we have devices from Rode and Schwarz. Is there any overview of how to recognize these? Yes, looking for patents is really helpful in discovering these manufacturers. I don't have a list myself, but these are the big players, Coppem, Rode and Schwarz, Israeli manufacturers, Swiss manufacturers, but there is no one list, at least not that I've found. You could maybe start compiling one in Wikipedia.
So, einmal hinten das Mikrofon, bitte.
The microphone at the back, please. I was wondering about the remote downgrade over SS7. You said that
provider data manipuliert.
That it manipulates data at the home provider. Did I get that right? And does that require their permission, or do you open a new one? It's interesting. It's a very new method. We wonder how that might be, how they might be pulling that off. They're advertising it, but it's very new. You need to be able to access SS7, and once you have that, there is generally a certain trust. It's a very old protocol, and you're basically allowed to do what you want, because it's assumed that it's only being used by benevolent actors. So I imagine you need access to SS7, not much more. Is there a way to prevent the 2G downgrade and to only allow your phone to use 3G and 4G, maybe even to restrict it to certain encryptions? There are telephone settings for this, but because the baseband is a black box, I'm not sure how trustworthy these are. I think it's a good idea if you live in a city that has good 4G coverage. You can do that in your Android ROM or whatever, but I wouldn't trust it 100%, because at the end of the day you don't know what the baseband is doing, but it's a good idea to try.
So, haben wir eine weitere Frage?
Are there any more questions? Yes. What kind of components do you need to build an IMSI catcher? How complicated is that?
Ja, du brauchst also im Prinzip ist das.
You basically need, well, there are USB sticks that have Qualcomm basebands that are LTE modules. You need a Linux. You can open the DIAC interface as a serial interface, and there's a DIAC parser that's really helpful that allows you to read the communication over the interface, and then Wireshark on top lets you dig for things in the output, and then you'd need to put it all together and look for these parameters, but it's essentially a fairly simple setup.
Ja, gibt es noch andere Möglichkeiten?
Are there other methods than apps such as Snoop Snitch for discovering or avoiding IMSI catchers? Not that I know of. There's AEM something, but they don't use the DIAC interface. Instead, they try to play numbers games and look up cell IDs and open cell IDs and other data. I don't think that gets you far enough. You can see certain things when they're sufficiently rough with certain IMSI catchers, but you basically have to dig deep into the protocol, and I haven't seen any that do this, so I'd have to say that Snoop Snitch has done a pretty good job at this.
Ich hätte noch eine Frage. Wie sieht es mit anderen Vendors aus?
How about other vendors than Qualcomm's, for example, MediaTek or Intel or Infineon chips? They have the same problem. They have to talk the GSM 3G, 4G specs, and that makes them vulnerable to IMSI catches. And at the same time, you don't have an interface such as DIAG to observe them, or at least I don't know that they have one. Intel basebands used to have a method of looking deeper into this, but I'm not sure if that's still possible.
Da war eine Frage.
Hi, du hast über Analyse und
you spoke of methods of analysis and defense, but a slightly evil question: do you know any offensive methods to work with IMSI catchers, or what do you think about this? I think it's something we have to consider and we have to think about. The scenario would be to simply DOS the IMSI catcher with lots of basebands that try to dial in and thus exhaust its resources. But the problem is that this would also endanger benevolent base station, so it's not really a scenario that I want to work on any further. But a simple thing you can do is once you've recognized an IMSI catcher to find it physically and remove it. But it's if you have a larger area, that may not be quite as simple, but that's the most useful scenario I can consider.
Vielleicht das Internet noch ein bisschen?
Does the internet have any more questions, perhaps?
Da kommt jemand.
Somebody's coming.
Ach, da hinten.
Da die IMSI-Catcher ja auf IMEI und IMSI...
IMSI-Catchers use IMEI and IMSI.
Schnell zu wechseln.
Are there any methods to quickly change these numbers?
Also ja, es ist schwierig, die IMEI...
It's difficult. The IMEI is...
fest vergeben und kann nicht geändert werden.
Fixed and unchangeable, immutable in any baseband that's being assigned. Of course, you could try to reverse engineer the software that's running on it and to manipulate certain values. It's an idea. It's possible that, but it's not really possible to spoof it. You're not supposed to be able to do that. As far as IMSI goes, I don't see a lot of opportunity. Because it's the central element of authenticating with your operator, who then allows you to use the telephone or the internet. So once you spoof that, you're no longer allowed to use the network. So it's impossible for IMSI, it's potentially possible for IMEI.
Internet?
Any questions from the internet?
Alle schon weggeschmolzen?
All everybody has melted.
Gut, dann bitte einmal
Applaus. All right, applause. Thank you. Thank you.